The curfew is ending. Another night of fear is over. Dawn in Kampala. Nighttime killings have been a commonplace since Amin's regime collapsed in anarchy last April. A police force patrols, but is making slow headway against the tide of violence. This patrol has been alerted to a break-in by armed looters, probably men from Amin's army still on the run. But this is not yet the Ugandan police force. Most of these men are from Tanzania, Uganda's neighbour that was finally driven to destroy Amin. By the time this patrol arrived, the looters had fled. Yet one more unresolved crime. In central Kampala, there has been an improvement in security. But in some of the suburbs, the killing goes on unabated. Well before nightfall, most local residents flee to safer areas. One man who chose to stay describes the latest cold-blooded killings.
Some unknown assailants entered through the back door of the house,
yes,
which had been left unclosed since they are not going to sleep yet.
Yes.
So they first had a gun shot in the corridor of the house, and everybody went into panic. One of the assailants shouted, "Here is an enemy." And the man heading the gun turned around and shot him dead. Then Dan, they flashed a torch at Dan, and they saw he was a young boy, so they commented, "He's a young lad, leave him." And the woman whom they had removed the cash from talked to the robbers and said, "You have taken all the money you wanted. Why do you take me now? They said, "Let's go." She said, "I cannot go. If you want, you can kill me here. But you have taken all that I have. What's the use of taking me?" And they shot her dead.
What's left of the Uganda police force is a pretty poor match for the killers. Many policemen simply threw away their uniforms when Amin fell. Others had them stolen instead.
Stand up!
As a deterrent, the city would be better off with Fred Karno's army.
Stand up!
Most of you, I believe, know your places of duties. I don't want you to get lost. And I also warn you to behave well, because the people you are going to guard are diplomats. Have you got any problem with your firearms? You don't have any problem. Have you had your supper?
It will take years to rehabilitate the Uganda police. And in the meantime, only a large outside force can hope to keep the lid on. Because not all the killings have simple robbery as a motive. Some have political overtones. This is the tomb of the Kings of Buganda, now part of the modern Ugandan Republic. Princess Irene is the sister of the late King Freddy of Buganda. Just a few weeks ago, armed men broke into the family compound.
My son said, "I have no money. Today is, I think it was a holiday day. We didn't go to the bank, but I have no money now." And they tell him to shoot him. I was in the window. I saw them, and my son was holding here.
He'd been shot.
He fell down and died.
David Barlow has been chief of police since Amin's overthrow, and the murders have come tragically close to home. Barlow's own brother was recently assassinated.
Yes, unfortunately that happened. But I think apart, some of these are political, or were political. But a number of them can be attributed to just people settling old scores. Now, in the confusion and with so many guns running around, it was a bit difficult to identify who is doing what.
Even on law and order, Uganda needs massive help if she's to struggle to her feet again. This junkyard is the country's main police workshop. Apart from some Land Rovers sent in by the British, the Uganda police are virtually immobile. With vehicles abandoned during the fighting or just seized up through neglect under Amin, the police are having to start all over again. And what goes for the police goes for every other institution in Uganda. The British have so far spent £2 million helping Uganda recover from the ravages of Idi Amin. And now there's another £5 million in the kitty for next year. That's actually more than most other governments have given. But it's only a tiny fraction of Uganda's needs. The war that destroyed Amin also flattened whole towns on the invasion route from Tanzania. This is Umbarara, the biggest town in the southwest, which was dynamited in retaliation for damage done by Amin's men in Tanzania. Because of lack of building materials, Umbarara remains in the same state as it was left by the invasion force. War debris still clutters the streets 9 months after Amin's rule collapsed. The capital, Kampala, took its share of the damage. Buildings were blown up by Amin's men in retreat, or destroyed later because of their association with the fallen dictator. Almost everything that worked was either burnt or looted. And as well as the physical destruction of war, there is also all the damage done to Uganda by 8 years of Amin's rapacious and incompetent rule. This Commonwealth report, prepared in June, concluded that Uganda needed £750 million in reconstruction aid over the next 2 years, and it's now sadly apparent that the country will be very lucky to get a tenth of that figure. Western governments, our own included, plead economic problems at home for saving on foreign aid. But as this report says, those who think like that should try living in Uganda. Mulago Hospital, once the finest in Black Africa. Now, after Amin, it's near breakdown. Because most other hospitals are closed, Mulago is grossly overcrowded. The hospital chief lists some of his other problems.
During the past 8 years, the problem has been that the hospital has been allowed to deteriorate because of lack of equipment, lack of spares, lack of drugs, and lack of medical personnel.
Hopeful patients come from all over Uganda with prescriptions for drugs, but even Mulago can supply only a very few of them. In the wards, medical staff can't provide proper treatment, and even the hospital's medical degrees have been struck off by our own medical council. There are other acute shortages, not enough mattresses for the beds. The hospital radiologist demonstrates the hazards of his faulty X-ray equipment.
You could easily make an accident because you are so few people. Otherwise, you need two other people to hold on to the table on the other side so that it doesn't fall over, otherwise the patient may roll off.
Lack of foreign help under Amin meant that maintenance work suffered. Anesthetic equipment is either dangerous or unworkable. Water shortages mean that equipment can't be properly sterilized. And the worst shortage of all is in skilled doctors and surgeons to perform operations. Mulago is working on just a third of its proper establishment.
In certain areas, we are really depleted to almost one man. We have one radiologist left, one anesthetist left, no ENT surgeon left. So these are areas where we are really very thin on the ground.
On the face of it, life in much of the capital seems normal enough. But closer inspection shows the full impact of the economic hurricane that has struck Uganda. These shops were once owned by the Asian traders whom Amin expelled. Their businesses were handed over to Africans and then later systematically looted at the time of Amin's overthrow. If they were still here, the Asians might be filling their shops with imported goods. But who in these circumstances would give a Ugandan trader credit? What commerce there is in Kampala has been transferred far from the main streets. This is what economists call the informal economy, what we would call the black market. Open-air markets have mushroomed all around the capital. If you have the money, this is where you come to buy basic household goods. And you need a lot of money. All manufactured items on sale here are smuggled because Uganda has next to no foreign exchange. Goods come across the border from Kenya, where Ugandan currency is a bad joke. The result is that a bag of flour will cost you £5, a bar of soap about £3.40, washing powder £4, and matches precisely 72 pence. In fact, everything costs about 10 times its proper price. What is Uganda's new president doing about it?
This is the $1 million question, because you see, there is black market, or to use the Swahili term, magendo. There is magendo because Idi Amin went on printing money. Every time he was short of money, he just went on printing more money. As a consequence, we had too much Idi Amin money chasing too few goods. The usual spiral of galloping inflation. You know, it was galloping at the rate of about 200% per year.
And it strikes us as being so pervasive now that it must be almost impossible for any Ugandan to live in the legal economy.
It's very difficult. Well, now we're trying to solve it by particularly importing what we call the bare essentials.
These queues are for the first fixed-price sugar to be seen in Kampala for 5 years. Before Amin, Uganda was a sugar exporter, but now the shortages are so acute that much of the sugar on sale here today will be resold up the road on the black market.
Why are you queuing?
Because it is being provided at government price now.
What is the government price?
15 shillings.
What price do you normally have to pay?
100.
A struggle to buy food, and because of transport shortages, a struggle even to get home at night before the curfew. Unless, of course, you happen to be agile and in uniform. But it's thanks to the country around the towns that there has not been starvation in Uganda as well. Throw something on the ground, say the Ugandans, and it grows 10 feet tall. Uganda is a country of smallholders, and during the Amin years, town dwellers were able simply to return to the land to keep their families alive. It's also on that natural good fortune that Uganda's economic revival will depend.
Coffee beans have always been Uganda's biggest export earner. But here again, the Amin years took a terrible toll. Amin's men went in for wholesale coffee smuggling, and prices to small producers like these declined. The result was decay and neglect on the small coffee plantations.
And as Uganda's economic decline accelerated, more and more small farmers went back to growing food for themselves and for the local market. Power generation at Uganda's once thriving industrial centre at Jinja has declined, but then local industry hasn't required much electricity. The Dunlop tyre factory has just had to shut up shop because of a raw material shortage. And Uganda's only steel plant faces closure soon because there is no foreign exchange to buy scrap. When Amin nationalised the plant and expelled its Asian owners, the Madvanis, it was producing 18,000 tonnes of steel a year. It's now producing less than 3,000 tonnes. And some weeks, they don't even bother to light the furnaces. The Madvanis were Uganda's biggest industrialists. Their opulent mansions are almost as they left them when they fled 7 years ago. Only the recent fighting around Jinja has caused some destruction. And now the Madvanis are to be allowed back under an advantageous bargain struck with the new government. But 40,000 Asians were thrown out altogether, most of them shop owners. I asked the president whether he would invite them back to help the Ugandan economy.
No, I wouldn't. Because I'm saying it in good faith, and this is the belief of the majority of the Ugandans. The Ugandans would rather suffer for 2-3 years more and restore themselves to prosperity than having Asian retailers coming back to manage their shops. I think the only role some Asians could play, the role like the Madvani family, the sugar tycoons like Mahendra Mehta family, you know, the big estates where they can really inject new capital into industry.
So you lend at least that much support to the policies of Idi Amin?
No, I don't think so. I'm not lending any kind of support to him. I mean, I detest the method he used to evict them. I think the method was barbarous, to say the least. But I think the results which were achieved by using that kind of brutal method of evicting them is a point of no return as far as ordinary Ugandans are concerned.
Bob Astles is held here in Luzira prison, Kampala, with another 1,500 Amin men. For the first time, permission was given to take television cameras into Luzira prison. When Amin was overthrown, all his prisons were ransacked, and until recently, only this one was secure enough for prisoners. Luzira itself was looted, even of its locks and keys. And while they wait for replacements, the gate to the main exercise yard is secured by handcuffs. Bob Astles is held in the prison's condemned section, and special arrangements were made to bring him to the main yard. And we were allowed to talk to him in his condemned prisoner's uniform, on condition that we didn't discuss the details of the murder and robbery charges he faces.
Mr. Astles, what are conditions like for you here?
I've only got one complaint only, and that is about food. That's the only complaint.
What's the food like?
Well, for me, it's almost impossible. At this moment, I'm taking porridge every day. However, the prison staff here, in their own way, managed to keep me provided. And we're just hoping for an improvement. A lot of this, we know, is due to the fact that there are problems outside. Shortage of transport due to the war, people not cooperating with the government, and so on. Perhaps a lot of selfishness involved.
You're getting some food from outside, though, are you?
Oh, yes. There's always a way in life.
Bob Astles makes regular appearances in court as his case proceeds. But what about other Amin detainees held without trial?
Some were members of the notorious state research. Some were members of the notorious public safety unit. Some had committed outrageous crimes against humanity. Some of them are going to be tried in special courts called human rights courts. This is on the kind of scale as the Nuremberg trials at the end of the Second World War.
But it is not only Amin men who have been jailed. A number of journalists and lawyers have been held without trial, casting the first doubts on the president's claims to be running a regime worth helping. The chairman of the Law Society, Sam Njuba, was arrested because he criticized the government.
I was held in the condemned section of Luzira, upper prison Luzira.
The condemned section?
Yes.
What did did you actually fear for your life?
Yes, I did, and I can forget everything, but I can't forget the fact that I was detained with people like Abdul Nasuru and other Amin's men, and everybody knows that I have never been Amin's man. So anything which could have happened to Amin's soldiers could have happened to me. I was wearing the same uniform.
We are in the process of repealing the Preventive Detention Act. We're going to replace it by a very lenient kind of statute, just style the statute of public order and public security, whereby we shall be in a position to just to take a chap out of circulation for a few months. And also we shall allow those people who we take out of circulation to live with their families, enjoy the consortium of their wives and kids, and also giving them a bit of pocket money to eat the food of their own choice. And also, furthermore, if the courts recommend, if a review committee recommends their release, the Minister of Internal Affairs or whichever minister administers the act shall be bound to obey, to carry out the court order. They'll be released.
But powers to take chaps out of circulation are not the only worry about the new Uganda. Godfrey Binaisa, accompanied here by his watchful army chiefs, is already the second president since Amin. The way he came to power so angered Paulo Semwogerere that he refused to serve in the new cabinet.
It was mainly because I disapproved of the method that was followed to upset the previous government and to appoint the new one. It was also because I disapproved of the disregard of public opinion in the country.
Why then do you think that Professor Lule was removed as president?
I think it was power struggle in the Consultative Council.
I think the Consultative Council is now effectively an appointed parliament, isn't it? That's the position at the moment.
Yes, it's a de facto parliament now. But at that time, there were factions in the Consultative Council, and certain factions combined to remove him. And I believe that the main reason was for them to wield more power.
And that power struggle intensifies. This is Yoweri Museveni, a charismatic ex-guerrilla leader on the stomp in his own tribal area of southwestern Uganda. Last month, he was a powerful Minister of Defense. Then President Bin Aisa demoted him. But Museveni's supporters have resisted the move, and the wrangle is still not finally settled. It all suggests that Bin Aisa is not quite master in his own home, hardly the best way to impress aid givers in the West. The biggest doubt of all, though, concerns the role of the Tanzanian army. Long after the war, there are still 25,000 Tanzanian troops in Uganda. It's Tanzanians, not Ugandans, who man all the roadblocks. Without them, there would certainly be anarchy. Yet nothing is known of plans for a new Ugandan army, and there is no timetable for final Tanzanian withdrawal. Independent politicians are already voicing their misgivings.
I think it's unfortunate that the Tanzanian forces, which were asked to help us in liberation, would sometimes be asked to get involved in internal affairs. I think for the future relations of Uganda and Tanzania, it would be best for the Tanzanian forces to retain the good name they established when they liberated this country. They came for a duty for which they were prepared, and a duty they executed very well. But now, when they are asked to do something for which they are not well prepared, we are likely to get into difficulties, and we'll end up blaming the Tanzanians for some of our own problems.
Even in church, President Bin Aisa is closely guarded by the Tanzanians, but he acts as if he is free of their political influence. And it's a point he will have to prove if his unelected but tolerably liberal regime is to receive the further help it urgently needs. It's certainly in Britain's own interest to promote stability in the region. And Bin Aisa says we have another reason to remember Uganda.
We think that the West should feel guilty because there they are, highly civilized, highly developed, almost all of them Christian countries. They're the ones who introduced Christianity to Uganda. They just watched us being slaughtered by dictator Idi Amin without raising a finger. And it's only the United States, to their credit, who went to the extent of placing a trade embargo on Idi Amin's regime. But all the others just watched us. I mean, Britain used to supply Amin's army with all the liquor they wanted every week from Wanstead Airport. So now I think they should feel a little bit of a guilty conscience and come forward with some significant aid.